Welcome to our all-school mass. Today, in a special way, we gather to pray for, honor, and celebrate some of the most important people in our lives, our grandparents. Our grandparents are truly a profound gift to our lives. They have helped us form into the people we are today, and we thank God for their ongoing love and support. Today, during Mass, we also have the opportunity to reflect on how God wants us to set the world on fire. May we open our hearts to recognize how God is working in our lives and the ways in which He invites us to respond to His profound love.
As we prepare to start Mass, we would like to give you three reminders. One, students, please be respectful of those around you by not talking during Mass this morning. Two, do not be afraid to sing out loud. Three, please be reverent and respectful during communion. If you are not Catholic, please come forward to receive a blessing by crossing your hands over your chest like this.
Finally, we invite you to bring your whole self to this Mass. Bring your joys and struggles, disappointments, worries, doubts, and moments of happiness. We believe in a God who wants to meet us where we are on our journey. Use this time to pray through your daily life. Now let us take a moment to silence ourselves as we remember that we are in the presence of God. Please stand.
Please join us in singing "Lead Me, Lord."
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God the Father and may the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all today. And let me add my greeting to our grandparents who are participating online today, and also we remember the soccer team and Deacon Rick. He's with them today, so we remember them. As we come together to celebrate in word and in sacrament, we ask for the healing and the reconciling grace that we all need in our lives. We ask for the grace to accept God's forgiveness and the grace to extend it to one another. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners to yourself. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And you are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
My friends, let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
So, my friends, let us be seated and listen to the Word of God today. Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I am speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your nature. For just as you presented the parts of your bodies as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness for lawlessness, so now present them as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free from righteousness. But what profit did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit that you have leads to sanctification, and its end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. My brothers and my sisters, may the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Jesus said to his disciples, I have come to set the earth on fire, and how I wish it were already blazing. There is a baptism with which I must be baptized, and how great is my anguish until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to establish peace on the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, a household of five will be divided, three against two and two against three. A father will be divided against his son and a son against his father, a mother against her daughter and a daughter against her mother, a mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated, everybody. Okay, so I've been thinking a lot about how to make a welcome of our grandparents and that gospel reading go together. Because it sounds like Jesus is talking about the disillusion of the family rather than the unity of the family, which I would ask our grandparents to be leaders in the unity of our families. And so instead, I'm going to focus on the other image in the gospel. I'm just going to ignore that part for now. I'm going to focus on the image of fire. For those of us who live in the West, a raging wildfire is probably not the first thing that comes to mind when we think about the power of Jesus Christ in our lives and the power of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. But many of the holy women and men of our history have reflected on that image of a fire as really instructive about how God works with us. And I just want to reflect on that a little bit. I love when the real concrete things that we use, and especially the most simple things that we use in our lives, are vehicles of God's self-communication to us. That's what's at the heart of the Eucharist, is that bread and wine, those things that we need to keep our bodies healthy and alive, food and drink, becomes God for us, becomes God's self-communication to us. That's the essence of what a sacrament is in the Holy Catholic Church. And fire is one of those symbols, and it's worth our reflection. So let's think about how fire works just in human life, right? I read somewhere that if you're going to refine gold, and refining gold means removing its impurities, you need to heat it to a liquid state. And then the impurities of the gold will rise to the top, and they're easy to skim off. And what you're left with after refining the gold in a hot, hot fire is the pure gold. St. John of the Cross, the wonderful mystic of the church, had a lot to say about the image of fire. And he said, you know, when you put a log on a fire, the reason it starts popping and snapping is because the sap and all the stuff that is impure is coming out, and it won't burn, so it has to pop. And what happens to the log as it burns is it eventually becomes one with the fire, and then it's able to emit its heat and its light for our warmth and for our enjoyment and our pleasure. So we're getting closer now, if we think about those things, to what the kind of fire that Jesus says he wants to set on the earth. It's not a fire that destroys. It's not a fire that sends smoke into the Treasure Valley so that we have a hard time even going outside. That's not the kind of fire. The kind of fire that Jesus wants to start and the kind of fire that Jesus wishes were already blazing is the fire of passion for his love, passion for his word, passion for his grace, and passion for his kingdom in the world. It's the kind of fire that happens when we discover who we're truly meant to be. And not only who we're truly meant to be, as though God is going to ask us to do something we don't want to do. No, who we're truly meant to be is what will make us the most happy also. God's will for us is ultimately our deepest will for ourselves. That's the key to understanding discernment of spirits and deciding what it is we're going to be with our lives, how we're going to use this precious life that we've been given to make ourselves and those around us happier and more fulfilled. That's the kind of fire that Jesus wants to enkindle in us. And it's a fire that doesn't consume wood. It's a fire that purifies hearts. It's a fire that purifies hearts and makes them more pure, makes them better able to respond to God's call in the world. That's the kind of fire that Jesus wishes were already blazing. And sometimes, guess what? That kind of fire can be a stress in families. Because if somebody discovers that deep grace and others in the family haven't, then there will be conflict and there will be a little bit of tension. And I think that helps me to understand that second half of the gospel reading. So how do you discover that fire? Bishop Kelly is the place that all of us have been asked to be for this precious moment, to discover and to enkindle the fire in our hearts. That fire that shows you who you're supposed to be, that fire that reveals to you God's will and your deepest will for yourself, is the fire that you discover in athletics and activities. It's the fire that you discover in classes by learning what subjects you have passion about. It's the fire that you discover by learning how to pray. It's the fire that you discover even by asking your questions of God and then being patient and humble enough to know that God will answer you. Maybe not in the way you want and maybe not in the time frame you think, but that God will answer. If you ask a question of God, God will provide the answer. We just have to have the ears to hear it and the heart to accept the answer that we're given. So that's the fire. That's the fire that Jesus wishes were raging. Can you imagine what the world would be like if everybody responded to that fire? If everybody recognized how indescribably he or she is? If everybody realized that they are an unrepeatable image and likeness of God in the world? If they realized that their call was not just to do what makes them happy, but to make others happy as well. And to sacrifice, if we had a sense that sacrifice sometimes is worth it. It's an athletic lesson, it's an academic lesson, why can't it be a spiritual lesson as well? Can you imagine what the world would be like if everybody lived that way? It would be a whole lot better than it is right now. With all the disagreements and all the arguments and all the violence and all the misconception that we have in our world today, if we all listened to what God is asking of us and if we had the generosity to respond. That's the fire that Jesus wishes to enkindle right now in each one of our hearts. That's the fire to which we are called as members of this Bishop Kelly community. That's the fire that our grandparents have to keep remembering us come back to, and to help us to embrace ever more deeply in our lives. And so today, as we celebrate this Mass, we ask that that fire be enkindled in our hearts, and that through us it be enkindled in each other, and that we start a raging blaze of purification of hearts, a raging blaze of holiness and morality and sanctity and commitment and passion and, above all, joy in following God's call in the world. May God set us on fire for his kingdom and for his justice and for his community here on earth. God bless us all, and God bless our grandparents. We pray for you in a very special way this day. My friends, let's stand. And as a people deeply wishing for the fire of Christ's love and passion in our hearts, we ask for what it is we need this day for ourselves and for one another. We offer our prayers to God.
For the church, especially those who serve as ministers, that the Holy Spirit will fill their hearts and minds as they seek to bring Christ to those in need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That during this Respect Life Month, our hope in Christ's resurrection will strengthen us in protecting the dignity of all human life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all of our grandparents, that God would fill their hearts with great joy, and may they know our love and thanksgiving for their constant support, wisdom, and inspiration. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the freshman class. As they settle into the school year, may they feel loved, supported, and connected by their peers, teachers, and this community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for a number of our fall sports teams as they head to district and state competitions this week and next. We pray for safe travel and protection upon them and ask for your grace to guide them as they compete to the best of their abilities. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all of the sick and suffering in our community, that God's healing hand may be upon them and strengthen those who care for them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all that have gone before us, that through God's saving power, they will experience the rewards of eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers and intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
So loving and gracious and life-giving God, God of all passion, commitment, and joy, we offer you the prayers we speak aloud and the ones we hold in the silence of our hearts, that you might answer them in your good time and in your good way. For we make them all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's be seated as we prepare the table. Please stand, everyone. So my brothers and my sisters, let us pray together that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands and the praise and the glory of his name for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Amen. Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying actions of your grace, we may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. His death we celebrate in love. His resurrection we confess with living faith, and his coming again in glory we await with unwavering hope. So with all the angels and saints we praise you, as without end we acclaim together. Remain standing. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of our faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be here in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Peter, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and our sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. So now at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we have the courage to pray in the words he gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
And Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles and who say to each one of us, "My peace I leave with you, my peace is my gift to you," look not upon our many sins, but look instead upon the faith of your church gathered here, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. My friends, may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's turn to each other and offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. My friends, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. How blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and the blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. Body of Christ. Sanctuary for you. Probably a good idea.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn. Hold out your
your word. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still hold the candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world.
My friends, let us stand and pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. There are no announcements, right, Mrs. Horn? I just want to thank everybody that worked so hard to put this mass together. We didn't have any of the hosts blow away, which was one of my great fears, so thank God for that. And thank you very, very much to our musicians today. Thank you. Beautiful. And also thank you to Mrs. Horn and the campus ministers today. Thank you very much. Once again, grandparents, please know of our prayers for you, our blessings for you, our love, and our devotion to you. And I always think about this on Grandparents' Day because all mine are gone to God already. I'd like one of you to adopt me as your grandson. My friends, may the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you and keep you, the God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord in our love and our service of each other. Thanks be to God.
Please join us in singing Unstoppable God.